Good morning, everyone. Very warm welcome to you all this morning. I wonder what you thought when you woke up this morning. Did you think, oh, it's Sunday, better turn out and go to church? Or did you wake up and think, oh, it's Sunday, I can't wait to get to church? Hopefully we feel a little bit like the psalmist when he says in Psalm 122, I rejoiced with those who said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Well, if you didn't feel like rejoicing coming to the house of the Lord when you got out of bed this morning, it's my prayer that you'll feel like rejoicing the Lord now and through the service and after the service as well. And we're going to stand and we're going to sing about our real reason for rejoicing, because we're going to stand in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene. Would you like to stand with us? First song this morning. Seated. And let's just be quiet in the presence of that wonderful, marvelous, saving Lord Jesus. Lord God, how blessed and privileged we are to be able to worship freely here this morning. How blessed and privileged we are to know that you have sent your Son to be our Savior. How blessed and privileged we are that we can come to you just as we are. And so we do that as we say together, Father eternal, giver of light and grace, We have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in what we have thought, in what we have said and done, through ignorance, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We have wounded your love and marred your image in us. We are sorry and ashamed and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and lead us out from darkness to walk as children of light. Amen. Father God, how wonderful, how marvelous it is to know that when we come to you in repentance, admitting how far we have fallen from grace, how much we are in need of your forgiveness, we thank you this morning that you have offered us and freely given to us the gift of forgiveness, and we receive it in humble gratitude through Jesus our Lord. Amen. So our first reading this morning comes from Paul's letter to the Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 4, the first six verses. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So during the singing of, no, we'll sing the next song through a couple of times. The second time we sing it, we're going to sing You Shall Go Out With Joy. And in the second time we sing it, the children will do precisely that. They will leave us with joy and dancing, and we will see them again later. So let's stand and let's sing We Shall Go Out With Joy and Be Led Forth With Peace. Oh, go out in the third time, okay? Not once, not the second, but the third time the children leave us, okay? But if you go out in the second one, anyway. Please stand.
Shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace.
children gone with joy, love? Would you like to be seated? It's always good to remind us of what we believe as followers of Jesus. And so we're going to say together the creed before Ruth comes and brings us our second reading. So let us affirm our faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. We say together, though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a slave. He was born in human likeness. He humbled himself and was obedient to death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God has raised him on high and given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Our second reading is taken from Mark chapter 3, starting in verse 20. Then Jesus entered a house, and again a crowd gathered, so that he and his disciples were not even able to eat. When his family heard about this, they went to take charge of him, for they said, "He is out of his mind." And the teachers of the law who came down from Jerusalem said, "He is possessed by Beelzebub, by the prince of demons. He is driving out demons." So Jesus called them over to him and began to speak to them in parables. How can Satan drive out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan opposes himself and he is divided, he cannot stand. His end has come. In fact, no one can enter a strong man's house without first tying him up. Then he can plunder the strong man's house. Truly, I tell you, people can be forgiven all their sins and every slander they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. They are guilty of an eternal sin. He said this because they were saying, "He has an impure spirit." Then Jesus' mother and brothers arrived. Standing outside, they sent someone in to call him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they told him, "Your mother and brothers are outside looking for you." "Who are my mother and my brothers?" he asked. Then he looked at those seated in a circle around him and said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother." This is the word of the Lord.
Lord, I just pray that you'll take my words this morning and speak through them in Jesus' name. Amen. When I was in parish ministry and used to go around and visit people about baptisms, I used to take the approach that if somebody was not a church member, I would try to encourage them to go for a Thanksgiving and explain all the reasons why to do that. And on this particular occasion, I thought I was making quite a lot of headway. And the husband, I realise in retrospect it was the husband, who was saying, "Yeah, I agree with that. Yeah, I think that's absolutely right." And at the end of it, he turned around to his wife and said, "What do you think?" She said, "We're having it done." End of conversation. They had it done. And I wonder how often we come across that sort of closed mind. People are not prepared to discuss or open their minds to new things. They've got their set position, closed mind, that's it. We're going to get the baby done, or whatever the equivalent might be. Or I wonder, too, if we sometimes come across a situation where we've done things for what we think are good and right motives, but then we find our motives questioned. On a couple of occasions, I found working in Lesotho, where we felt we were doing so very much with altruistic motives, being accused of colonialism by people. Mind, it was interesting, in one case, shortly afterwards, they asked for money. But what we felt were good motives being questioned. And I'm sure some of us have felt that, perhaps when we open a door to a young lady or give up a seat on the bus or whatever, and being told that we're sexist or whatever. Mine, it's great, isn't it, to get to an age where you start thinking, actually, perhaps they should be giving up the seat on the bus for me. I'm old enough now to do that. But quite often, we do things for right reasons, and we find our motives questioned. And it seems that those two things are happening in this passage with Jesus. Firstly, Jesus is coming up against closed minds. Jesus is coming up against closed minds. They were simply closed to the possibility that God could be at work in Jesus. I wonder how often we come across that sort of closed minds. People have come to the conclusion that there is no God, and therefore any reference to God activity must have an alternative explanation. The assumption is there is no God, therefore all these things have to be explained away in some other way. Even worse, when we come across Christians whose minds are not willing to hear another point of view, who've closed their minds to the way that God might be working and active and present in our world today, and as a result, can miss out on what God is in fact doing in his world today. So firstly, he was coming across these religious rulers with closed minds. But secondly, they were attributing good to bad. They believed that Jesus was casting out demons by using demons. And Jesus points out that no divided kingdom will stand. It will fall. If a kingdom is divided against itself, then it will fall. Can you imagine if your favorite football team started tackling each other? How easy it would be for the opponents to score. Sometimes I wonder if some teams are doing that anyway. But Jesus points out this is all nonsense, isn't it? He's saying, how can I cast out demons in the power of Beelzebub? There is no way that is going to happen. A kingdom divided against itself will not stand. And as I said before, we perhaps have been victims of that. People attributing our right and good motives as something that is bad. And Jesus says this can lead to the unforgivable sin, the sin against the Holy Spirit. Now, I don't believe, and I think commentators don't believe, that this is a one-off sin that he's referring to, that at some point in my life I've done something that offends the Holy Spirit and therefore God's written us off as a result. That seems contrary to the rest of Jesus' teaching, where he talks, for instance, you know, how often do you forgive your brother? 70 times 70. And his plea on the cross, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Almost certainly, Jesus is not referring to a one-off incident that might condemn us forever. Instead, it seems he's talking about a state of being, perhaps most particularly, and we need to hear this, most particularly amongst religious people, religious rulers, religious leaders, when they are so distorted in their thinking that they attribute things of God to the devil. In other words, their minds are so closed to God that they cannot actually see the present workings of God in the church and in our lives. And I think we can see something of this. As many of you know, Margaret and I started off our ministry in Chester Street. Kerry, who came here as well, also started. A number of us were there at the time. And we saw a huge growth in the church at Chester Street in the early 80s. Official figures show that sometimes it got up to 1,000 worshippers on a Sunday morning. Huge growth. What was the approach of the diocese? The diocese decided they were going to normalize it. and they took steps to reverse that process. Impossible to believe, isn't it? But it's true. Absolutely true. So closed that they couldn't see what God was doing today. We've taken for granted the charismatic movement, but I remember as a young Christian, when the charismatic movement came onto the scene, many Christians condemned it. This couldn't really be the work of God. It's far too enthusiastic, far too life-changing. This really can't be the word of God at all. Seems incredible today, but it's absolutely true. Some people actually attributed some of the things that were happening to the devil. It's not just the Sadducees 2,000 years ago who were closed to the idea that God was working and active today. We can be so today. Now, I'm not saying equally that we should accept everything that happens as being from God. We need discernment. We need to understand what is happening. But we need to welcome the movement and activity of the Holy Spirit. So it seems that the unforgivable sin is a heart so closed to God that it does not recognize the works of the Spirit and indeed attributes the work of the Spirit to the devil. And I think that tells us that firstly, we need to protect ourselves against such cynicism. Those of us who have been Christians for many years, it's very easy to get slightly cynical about what is happening. Oh yeah, seen that before, and so on. We need to guard ourselves against cynicism because cynicism eventually stops us seeing God active in our world. But also, on the positive side, we need to rejoice in a God who is always challenging and doing new things. We shouldn't be afraid of the fact that God is changing things and doing things which perhaps we haven't done before, a new way of doing things, a new exciting way of doing things, or challenging us in a different way. God does that. And we should welcome it rather than be afraid or indeed, at the worst, attribute it to the work of the devil. So that's the first thing then. The unforgivable sin seems to be those who set their hearts so hard that actually they cannot open themselves to what God is doing today. And then secondly, we find his family is obviously worried about what Jesus was up to and they come to find him. And he's reminded that his family are outside. And Jesus says, basically, who is my family? This is my family, the new family of Christians and the church. Jesus uses the opportunity to remind us about where our allegiances should be. Now, this seems quite harsh today, partly because I think we often elevate the family almost to godlike status in our lives. But it reminds us that the family is not necessarily our top priority in life. And I wonder if this is such a foreign concept. I wonder how many of us have ever sung, I vow to thee my country, all other things above. How many people during the Second World War in occupied Europe were branded then and now as traitors because in reality they put their family above the state? There are certain times, don't we, where we expect people to have greater adherence to the state than we do to family and friends. We expect higher loyalties than the family. And today, in many parts of the world, this is a real issue for many Christians, particularly perhaps in the Muslim world, where for many Christians, to become a Christian is to set themselves against their family. Why do they do that? Because there is a higher loyalty, there is a higher allegiance than we do have to our family. Now, none of that is to disregard our commitments, our responsibilities to our family. Jesus is quite clear about that when he talks about Corbyn and how you shouldn't actually say, I abdicate my responsibility for my family because of what I'm trying to do for God. He's not saying that at all, but he is saying, and we need to hear this, he is saying our highest loyalty is to God rather than our family and friends. And Jesus is only being honest when he says there will be division because this loyalty will sometimes inevitably lead us to clashes. And we've probably all felt that in small ways in our families. Perhaps some of us have been a more severe experience of that. But inevitably, if our loyalty is to God, it is going to lead to clash and disunity and sometimes disharmony in our family and amongst our friends. Clearly, for many of us, there is no such division. And it's absolutely right that we respect and we serve our families. Don't go away saying, Rob says, oh, we shouldn't neglect our families. I'm not saying that at all. What I am saying is that as Christians, and we sing it time by time in almost every song we sing, our ultimate loyalty is to God and to serve him first and foremost. So that sounds quite divisive. But on the other hand, Jesus says, but hang on, guys. This also brings a new family as well. We have a wider family, the family of the Christian church, not just here in St. George's, but the wider Christian family there to encourage us and support us. He's not saying, look, you have to be effectively a single person all the rest of your life. You've got to give up all your family and friends and so on. He's saying, no, there is a new family and I am the head. And we are all part of the Christian family. So what are the two key takeaways then, really, from these passages? Firstly, I think we need to understand the danger of weary cynicism, closing ourselves to the activity of God, but instead welcome and rejoice in the new ways that God expresses himself from generation to generation. And secondly, we need to reaffirm our ultimate and greatest allegiance is to God and rejoice in the family that he has given us. Yes, to serve our families, our biological families, but also to rejoice in the family of God that each one of us is a part of and has been given to encourage us and strengthen us so that together we might serve God better. Amen.
Before we come to a time of prayer together, we're going to sing How Deep the Father's Love for Us, How Vast Beyond All Measure That He Should Give His Only Son to Make a Wretch, that's us, to Make a Wretch His Treasure. Let's stand and sing this together. like to be seated for prayer?
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come into your presence this morning to show our love and gratitude for your unfailing love and the many blessings that you give us. We pray that you will go before us this week as we are drawn into the world and its ways, and as we humble ourselves, you will give us direction and wisdom to face the challenges ahead. We ask for your grace and mercy to come upon us and renew your spirit in us. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear
our Almighty God, yet again we pray for our world, a world that never changes with its relentless wars, conflict, and terror, causing so much unnecessary suffering. Gracious Lord, let those who have endured the horrors be helped, comforted, and strengthened in their knowledge that you hold the power, your will be done in this time. Give them hope and trust when all hope seems lost to them. Let humanity prevail in these awful times. Lord, we pray that the whole world will wake up to the global climate change and environmental issues that are occurring so frequently. So many natural disasters of famine, flooding, fires, and earthquakes. We pray for all those who have been affected and plead, Lord, that the acknowledgement and action by those in power will proceed reassuring us and make a huge change to the future of our planet. We pray too for our country, its government, and our King. So many changes in the last few years causing disunity, uncertainty, and a fear for many. Heavenly Father, we ask that you will instill good judgment and wisdom to all those who make important decisions for us all. Let their power be of your world. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Gracious Lord, we thank you for our church and its many leaders worldwide, praying that all their ways will be your ways, led by love and understanding. We thank you for the many blessings you have given to our church, St. George's. Please be with us as we continue to do your work in Jesus' name, with fellowship, hospitality, and a huge love and commitment for our local community. We pray for good health and strength for Nick, Lucy, Elisheba, and Ralph as they continue to serve you and us. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Loving Father, we pray that you will uplift those who are suffering in pain, whether it be physical, emotional, or mental health. Strengthen them with your power of healing and soothe them in their despair and distress. We pray for Emma Purvis and those known to us. We pray also for those who are grieving a loss of a loved one. In their sorrow, fill them with peace. Let them find comfort in your presence as they grieve, especially today for the family of Mark Johnson. Heavenly Father, accept these prayers in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We come now to our communion part of our service, but before we meet round the Lord's table, we meet together as Christ's family, as Robert's talked about, as a family united in worship of our Lord, and as a family united in our desire to serve him. But we need to build one another up, don't we? That's what we're here to do with together this morning, to build up from Jesus' strength, but to build one another up. And so we do that by wishing and praying for each other the best we can do, and that's a peace. the peace that God can give, and God alone can give, that enables and inspires us through everyday living. So I invite you, if you can, to stand and share peace with people around you this morning. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Do that. The Lord's table. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let's give thanks to the Lord our God. It is always right to give you thanks, God our Father, loving and faithful, holy and strong. You made us and the whole universe, and you filled your world with life. You sent your Son to live among us, Jesus our Saviour, Mary's child. He suffered on the cross. He died to save us from our sins. He rose in glory from the dead. You send your Spirit to bring new life to the world and clothe us with power from on high. And so we join the angels to celebrate and say, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Father, on the night before he died, Jesus shared a meal with his friends. He took the bread and thanked you. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this to remember me. After the meal, Jesus took the cup of wine. He thanked you and he gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood, the new promise of God's unfailing love. Do this to remember me. Christ is the bread of life. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, Lord Jesus, until you come in glory. Father, as we receive this bread and wine, and remember his death and resurrection, send your Holy Spirit that we who share these gifts may be fed by Christ's body and his blood. Amen. Pour your Spirit on us, that we may love one another, work for the healing of the earth, and share the good news of Jesus as we wait for his coming in glory. Amen. All honor and praise belong to you, Father, with Jesus, your Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. We say together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. So we break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus is the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. So draw near with faith.
burns with holy fire, with splendor he is crowned. How awesome is the sight, a radiant King of light. Be still, for the glory of the Lord is shining.
Let's join together in saying this prayer. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. So our final song this morning, Christ Alone, a song of great hope, great expectation, great joy. Let's stand and we'll sing this together.
My comforter, my all in all.
Final blessing, if I could just let people know, if you don't receive mailing from the church by email, there are letters at the back of church from Nick for those who would need a hard copy. Please do take a copy of the letter that's from Nick this morning. Also, I think, am I right in thinking we have tea and coffee this morning?
I've set some up.
Well, stay and talk amongst yourselves this morning. Don't worry, love. No, we're staying. We'll talk amongst ourselves and then go home and have our Sunday lunch. So let's just pray together. God, our Father, we thank you for every opportunity that we have to serve you. Thank you for the opportunity to be here together this morning. Help us to reflect on what we have heard, what we have sung. Speak into our hearts and fill us with your presence and your joy as we go from here. Well, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit be with us and remain with us always. Amen. Amen. So let's go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen. Amen.